old 18th century European record for the reconstruction of Georgian-European relations. This is how I titled my present talk. It's not only addresses historical or current stereotypes about Georgia or the stereotypes to treat Georgia South Europe, but also tries to present you a less known or unknown Georgia. This obscurity is not caused by the lack of surviving documents. On the contrary, there is numerous of sources from the 17th, 18th century, and not only in the less spoken Georgian language, but also in Italian, French, and Latin, available in Rome, Istanbul, Montauban, Paris, Nepal. The records do survive, but the microhistories reflecting Georgian-European relations have been deliberately erased from history. Means the records do survive, but the microhistories reflecting Georgian-European relations have been deliberately erased from historical and collective memory. If it is in any way possible to methodologically ground my present talk, it can be qualified as a study of well-known memory, memory studies. Yet it's not concerned with the creation of memory, but on the contrary, with the deletion from memory of those microhistories that fell prey to powerful ideological myths. One of the successful ideological myths emerged at the end of 17th century to become firmly established in 18th century, and by the year 1801 to evolve into the idea of shared religion, common fight, and century-old friendship between two Christian nations, Georgia and Russia, the main strategic narrative of Georgia of the time. Now I'm going to speak about the stories arised from historical memory and the records kept in Italy and France from the two perspectives. 18th century Europe from the Georgian perspective and vice versa, 18th century Georgia from the European perspective. You may ask how I, as a medievalist, am related with these discussions. I'm interested in the historical paradigms of these reflections, and from this historical perspective, will relate them to the concept of the nation in the contemporary sense of the term. Nation is an uninterrupted line of hereditary succession, and the reflection is a guarantee of this heredity. So before I proceed to the central topic, I would like to touch one more question, which is not strictly academic, but quite relevant nowadays, especially as we are in Belgium, close to the European headquarters in Brussels. At the end of the 20th century, on January 27, 1999, then young Georgian, at the Parliamentary Assembly of Council of Europe, then young Georgian politician Zurab Joania closed his speech with the following question: I'm Georgian and therefore I'm European. There is hardly anyone in Georgia who is unaware of this statement, but if you further ask what does it mean to be European, most regrettably the answer will fall short for Europeanness. I'm sure that historical Europeans, annoyed with the problem of new Europeans or pretenders to Europeanness like Georgians, may find Zurab Joania's words over the ambitions in flight, and which is not at all surprising. However, I would like to briefly comment on the historical prerequisite of these statements and eventually approach to the central thesis today's talk, Georgia from the European perspective. To this end, we need to pose the following questions. What are those Western values that Georgia has possessed historically, apart from the long Christian tradition, which together with an ancient heritage is a fundamental feature of historical Europe? Now I'm not going to make an in-depth comparative analysis of historical Europe and Georgia, nor I'm going to describe how modern European values evolved over time, nor to extend to which of the values correspond to the principles Georgians, or more specifically Georgian culture-bearing core group tried to pursue. I will only draw your attention to a few examples. Humane and legal tradition of contemporary Europe are associated with equality, freedom, compassion, and respect for human dignity, not restricted to the dominant groups. It is in this context that I wish to touch upon several founding concepts of cultural of Georgian cultural memory. Compassion, solidarity, and empathy even for enemies who are the source of misfortune. Let me mention here a popular Georgian ballad, Lay of the Huntsman and the Tiger, one of the most widespread traditional hunting narrative from the ancient time. Those who have visited Tbilisi would most probably get a glimpse of a monument displaying a struggle between a tiger and a young huntsman. In the ballad, none of them wins, both die. The ballad features a lamenting mother telling a story of the death of her son, his attractiveness in strange and invincibility. Yet this lamentation is remarkable for something else. It is compassion towards and solidarity with the mother of the killer of her son, the tiger, that distinguishes her from other. But hand consort more gently than the mother's when in bitter pain. Perhaps the tiger's mother grieves and mourns her death with long lament. Perhaps her heart is bursting now with sobs that rend the firmament. So quickly will I go to her and stream those thoughts of her sorrow deep. She'll proudly tell me of her child, and we in common grief will weep. The mother of the young huntsman is able to understand others' pain and suffering. She does overcome the black and white thinking and rejects enemy-free dichotomy. It was the acknowledgement of the values that turned the entire village community against Araza, the male character from the poem by Vajab Shavela, the most European Georgian poet of all time. Araza recognized the dignity of an enemy who brought suffering to her family. Filled with compassion, she began to question the long-established sacralized canons of society that served to justify vengeance instead of respecting one's dignity. Araza and her husband, Muslim Jokola, managed to go against mainstream, see the absurdity of the canons, and uphold the dignity of a human person, even of an enemy. We should say that we are men, only we are raised by mothers, that our souls find rest while infidels must gasp eternally in peace. If lots we say we'll talking drow, the gods of the shine know better than what duals speak true through swear and oath. Diversity is a value. I will quote a line from a 12th century poem composed by the greatest of the Georgian poets, Shota Rustaveli. To us, men, he, it means the creator, has given the world infinite and variative, he possesses it. In these words, diversity of mankind and the universe is recognized as a valuable asset, as a gift. Appreciation of diversity, which is a basic value of modern developed world, and Europe in particular, is what connects historical Georgia with Europe. If we look through the history of European literature, the 12th century may appear quite an early period for strides for acknowledgement of diversity and its recognition as a value. This brief historical overview demonstrates the values Georgia shared not only with historical but also with contemporary Europe. Let me now go back to the main topic, 18th century Georgian-European relations, as evidenced by less known European sources. The Middle Ages have different chronological boundaries in the West and the East. The medieval period in Georgia lasted longer, to the 18th century, but initial signs of modern era became visible in the early 17th century. They are to be associated with the first envoy Nikiphoros Irbakh, dispatched by the Georgian king to Europe. Nikiphoros Cholokashvili, the same as Irbakh, visited Pope Urban VIII in the capacity of envoy of Georgian king Teimuras I. It was in Rome that the elements of modern era started to penetrate Georgian culture. Georgian letter types were first cast in Rome, and the first Georgian book was printed in Rome. Beginning from 1629, several Georgian books, including the first Georgian grammar compiled by the missionaries, important liturgical texts, a manual of the Georgian language, and Georgian-Italian dictionary were printed in Rome. Irbakh negotiated on behalf of the Georgian king with Pope Urban VIII for achieving union between the Georgian Church and the Roman Catholic Church. The correspondence surviving from that period provides highly interesting evidence on how the Georgian king and nobles viewed Georgia's relations with the West and how Europe saw the role of Georgia, surrounded by Muslim states, could take in Christendom, the West. The Georgian king promised the Pope and the, King Philip II of Spain that Georgians would fulfill all the conditions and enter into ecclesiastical union with the Roman Church. This way, the Roman See and its spiritual children, European kings, would have a reliable stronghold in the East. All subsequent Georgian kings through the 18th century would reaffirm this commitment by writ of loyalty. Let me now present you a letter sent by one of the Georgian kings to the Pope. Pledging to follow the advice and instructions of Holy Padres, King Georgi XI implores the Pope to shield the Georgian king, like the European sovereigns, against enemies. It was at that time that Italy closely familiarized itself with Georgia through the Italian missionaries. First of all, Gaetano Rasponi, Arcangelo Lamberti, Don Cristoforo de Castelli, Ambrogio degli Angeli, and so on. Famous Italian missionaries in the Orient, including Pietro della Valle, provided the Pope with a written account of the martyrdom of the aforementioned King Teimuras Mata, Queen Ketevan, who was tortured in Persia. This was yet another reminder to the Pope and all Christian fathers on their obligation to protect fellow Christians. In 1714, when almost a century has passed since the first mission, Suhan Sabah Orbeliani, a Basilian monk and uncle and mentor of King Wachtang VI, visited the Pope and the King of France. He presented to the Pope and his spiritual son, King Louis, a letter similar to those ones delivered by Nikiphoros Irbakh. The key message of the letter was, help us and make us your servants. Sabah's efforts failed to produce any political outcome, but did have a cultural impact, as Sabah tried to import into Georgia what he observed in Rome. King Wachtang VI regarded an important figure in relations with the East, and his role was not limited to the context of Georgia and Caucasus. The messages he sent to propaganda fide and European sovereigns through Catholic padres have not been properly studied. They include the letters signed by Wachtang VI, you can see here. It's a Georgian signature of Wachtang VI. Includes the letters of Wachtang VI, the decree of cooperation, it's an Italian translation of decree, and the encyclopedic letters, you see here, it's an only inception. And at the end, we have key of the encyclopedic, this one here, the one. Further study of these documents will provide an answer to the following question. What was the role of Georgian King Wachtang VI in relations between Europe and Asia? How were the issues raised in the incipient letters negotiated? How were the correspondence arrangements made? What kind of network exists between the Western sovereigns and the Georgian king? And finally, how are the letters related to the imprisonment of Wachtang VI by the Shah of Persia? The assistance in the release of Wachtang VI from the Shah's captivity was what Suhan Sabah solicited from the King of France and from Pope. There is sufficient documented evidence to prove that Russia's and Europe's interests in Georgia and the Caucasus in general intersected in the context of relations with the Muslim world, namely Persia and Turkey. Despite the variable preconditions and content, I mean changes in the context, political and economic take places in different epochs, the framing context remains unchanged. Changes are confined within the framework. This explains why the interest in the alliance with Georgia remains limited by the framing context. For Europe, the relevance of building relations or alliance with Georgia was determined by the importance of its relations with the Orient and the function the Black Sea or the Caucasus could assume within the framework of the relations. The question of the Russian interest is different. I will talk about it separately. In the early 17th century, when the aforementioned Georgian king Teimuras dispatched his envoy Nikephoros Irbakh to seek allies in Europe, Russia embarked on creating the central strategic narrative of the empire. The narrative is based on the idea of Russia as a guardian and ally of the neighboring Christian nations. Sources confirm that since 1483, Grand Princess of Moscow from Ivan III, later King of Russia, pledged assistance and allies to Georgian sovereigns against the Muslim world in return for allegiance to the King of Russia. Some of the Georgian kings did so and killed their own father and brothers, but none of the Russian kings ever provided any assistance. Yet they did their best to create tension between Georgia and the Muslim powers, tensions in which Georgians always ended up fighting and their own enraging Shah sultans. The Georgian search for Western allies has long history. In this talk, I will not touch the relations between the Crusaders and Georgians. Neither will I speak about the Queen Rusudan's letter sent to the Pope in the 13th century. This is interestingly dealt with in Peter Halfter's publications appearing in Le Museum. I will speak about the later period, namely the 18th century, which is when the main strategic narrative took shape. I will reflect on its prerequisites, the microhistories related by this narrative and its consequences. Georgian historiography and our historical memory in general contains strong stereotypes of Georgia concluding a treaty of alliance with Russia in the 18th century as the only chance to protect itself from the Muslim expulsion. The aforementioned unknown or less known sources kept in Italy and France, however, provide a different picture. It was before 1783 that Russia blocked all Georgian initiatives to establish contacts with European sovereigns and seek allies in Europe. Russia blocked both routes leading to Europe and the envoys sent by King Heraclius II to Europe. Let us track back in the events that took place before that time. Back in 1746, when staying in Istanbul on his way from Rome to Akhaltsikhe, Georgia, Prefect of Georgian Catholic Church, Claudio da Reggio, notified in writing Georgian missions in Rome on threats emanating from Russians. Citation? Sorry. I do not have the right not to warn Sacra Congregazione, other than your highness, of the trouble that I'm afraid is at Georgia's doorstep. These men, that means Penkler, tried to intimidate me and prevent me from going to their country, that means Georgia. He told me that Russia professed Rito Greco and therefore they were always called to support the confession. Correspondingly, they would remove from there, that means from Georgia, everything that undermined the confession. Penkler advised me not to go to that country. He reminded me of a terrible case that he said had taken place in Russia some time before, where they had hanged a missionary priest who was said to have secretly consecrated someone. He did not say whether this happened in Moscow or in Petersburg. He, that means Penkler, told me that if he left Georgia in peace and moved to any other part of Russia, Russian or Persia, to convert Turks, Jews, or any other nations, peoples. They would assume responsibility to provide protection and grant us all good in behalf of the Russian royal court. The aforementioned Penkler deftly escaped, leaving me alone for talks with a Russian official, minister, to tell him that I would obey him, but I told him that I was going to sacrifice life to my mission. As the situation has taken such a turn, I will try to stay in Akhaltsikhe as long as possible. It is not ruled out that the local Greek community will also start persecuting me there. The Historical Archives of Propaganda Fide, Volume 2, Folio 395-396, from 1746. The prefect's letter from 1746 was the first to reflect the Russian religious imperialism seen by Europeans at the mine as the mine strategy, mean for dominance and unified Aliyah and the method of winning influence and prominence there. A year later, in 1747, Claudio D'Areggio sent another letter to Propaganda Fide, this time from Akhaltsikhe, Georgia. As you know, the Holy Congregation, Sacra Congregazione, filed to prevent the disaster I had written to you about. Is already at Georgia's doorstep. This does not let us feel safe. We will soon be expelled from this mission. Mr. Penkler is already a resident, as has Irreconciliable Greco, the Historical Archives of Propaganda Fide, Volume 2, Folio 407. Russo and Greco must not be understood directly. Russo should be interpreted as someone serving the Russians, and Greco as a follower of Greek rite, an Orthodox Christian, because he was resident in Constantinople. It hence appears that Penkler, who was responsible for managing the Catholic affairs in Constantinople and who could not be dismissed from office by the Holy See, despite the warnings made by Claudio D'Areggio a year earlier, began to openly threaten the Catholics with the expulsion from Georgia. Constantinople was one of the two routes by which not only missionaries, but also Europeans, including merchants, would come to Georgia. Penkler managed to ensure reliable monitoring of the visiting missionaries and familiarized them with the interest of Governor Russo, recalling the cases of the already punished padres. He also reminded them of the fate that awaits those who go against the interest of Governor Russo, defender of Orthodox Christianity. Before the 1783 historic treaty, there had been numerous violent confrontations between the local religious majority and Catholics in countries that were under the influence of Persia and Turkey, including Georgia. When such a confrontation took place, the Roman Church managed to secure benevolence of Eastern rulers through the European ambassadors, persuading the best to protect missionaries with their help. Without assistance from Muslim governor and the French ambassador, even King Heraclius II, who was most benevolent towards Catholics, proved to be unable to stop violence in Gori and Tbilisi, missions inspired by external forces in 1755. The Pope emphasized in his letters to the Shah of Persia that Prince Heraclius' effort had proved to be futile and that Heraclius would find it difficult to cope alone with the enemies of Catholics, citation, who were injured by the presence of Catholics in Lys area, Volume 2, Folio 410. Let me hereby remind you that in 1783, Georgia signed a treaty of alliance with Russia, which obliged both countries to cooperate in military strategic sphere. The kingdom and other institutions, however, would return sovereignly and would not be regulated by the treaty. In 1801, Russia violated the treaty abolishing first kingship and then ecclesiastical autocephaly and divided Georgia into two parts, Tbilisi and Kutaisi provinces, Tbiliskaya and Kutaiskaya gubernia. The divided country was then incorporated into the Russian Empire. The aforementioned stories arised from historical memory are related to the period predating the treaty. In March 1781, Heraclius II dispatched Capuchin prefect Domenico da Trieste to Europe via Constantinople and instructed him to deliver letters urging for the alliance and assistance. The prefect was to go to Rome first and ask the Pope and the cardinals for letters of recommendation, lettera commendatitia, addressed to the Emperor Giuseppe II of Austria and immediately leave to Vienna. This is his letter. Heraclius' envoy, Padre Domenico da Trieste, died unexpectedly on 3rd July 1781 as he arrived in Constantinople. Padre Fortunato da Trento, serving in the Constantinople mission, was notified from Tbilisi of the letters and was instructed to immediately send them to Rome. However, it proved to be a difficult task. Here is what he wrote to the cardinal in Rome. After the death of Prefect Padre Domenico Triestino, I notified one person about his death so that he could come to the wakes. I also mentioned to him the letters which the prefect had carried with him. A couple of days later, the mentioned person sent me two letters, one after another, and ordered me not to send the letters to Rome. I replied then that I was obliged to send that letter to Your Eminence. Yesterday, I received another letter from him insisting me not sending the letters. To avoid conflict, I answered him that I would obey his order, but I did not do so. I'm sending you the mentioned letter so that Your Eminence can read it and decide what to do with it. I wish to believe that His Majesty the Emperor will send a response letter to King Heraclius II. If Your Eminence decides to send me the response letter, I assure you that I will arrange for its secure delivery personally to Heraclius. I know the ways how to do. I know reliable people and maintain correspondence with people in all Georgian provinces. At the same time, may I modestly warn Your Eminence that if you send the Emperor's response to someone else or to the person who is currently opposing, it means sending letters, the letters may end up in the hands of the people who are not acting on their own, but rather to appear those whom they serve. Volume 4, folio 55. According to the fourth volume of Propaganda Fide, folio 59, Padre Fortunato da Trento, who took care of Heraclius' letter, also died in 1781 in Constantinople in unclear circumstances. After this unsuccessful attempt, Heraclius tried another way to Europe, which went through Russia and Eastern Europe. On 14 November 1782, he sent another envoy, Polish-born missionary Capuchin Mauro de Verona, to Europe. Mauro di Verona had to deliver the king's letters to Europe and hold negotiations on behalf of Heraclius with the Pope and Rome and the French, Venetian, Sardinian, and Austrian courts. The new prefect of the Georgian mission, Andrea de Palermo, this time applied to Cardinal Borgia with a request to write a letter of recommendation for Heraclius' envoy. This is a Georgian letter from Heraclius II to Giuseppe II, The new, and the new prefect of the Georgian mission, Andrea da Palermo, this time applied to Cardinal Borgia in Rome with the request to write a letter of recommendation of Heraclius' envoy. On the orders, sending Padre Mauro da Verona to Vienna for the purposes explained in my two previous letters. I would appreciate if you could give him a letter of recommendation. As King Erekle hasted and became so impatient that ignored even the bad weather and poor condition of roads, volume 3, folio 103. Erekle did haste greatly. Only such haste can explain sending an envoy in November. Erekle was in such a hurry that he did not even wait for the letters to be translated and sent to Europe only Georgian originals, hoping that they would be translated at the court of the Austrian emperor. The main goal was to get the envoys across the borders of Georgia. Yet reckless effort again proved futile. He miscalculated the danger. The envoy did cross the Georgian border, but he never reached the court of European kings. He died on the way unexpectedly in unclear circumstances. His body was found in May 1783 in Bardicowa, Poland, by a local mission who did not spare efforts to deliver the Georgian king's letter to Vienna timely on early June. But the letters were written in Georgian, a language unknown to the Europeans, and on 19 June 1783, Padre Giuseppe sent them from Vienna to Italy for translation. Compare. This is the letter of Giuseppe to Rome, to Propaganda Fide. Last week, two Polish missionaries brought here, that means to Vienna, letters sent by King Erekle from Georgia, which Padre Mauro de Verona had on him. Padre was dispatched by King Erekle himself in order for him to hold negotiations on behalf of Erekle with various rulers and important matters. King Erekle's letters are written in Georgia. In Vienna, I could not find anyone knowing Georgian. Therefore, I'm sending them to Sacra Congregazione to find a translator. We gave passports to both Polish missionaries and issued open orders for all post offices so that they, that means Polish missionaries, be given free horses for their safe return to Poland. Propaganda Fide, volume 4, folio 114. Also, the letters were translated first into Turkish. You can see the written in Arabian. And then into Italian and Latin. The treaty signed between Russia and Georgia in 1783 in unclear circumstances left them devoid of any function. Tragic history of European missionaries continued even after that, but with one difference. Beginning from 1783, they fell victims not to Georgian kings, European aspirations, respectively, but to the protection of their religious, legal, and property rights in what's now reminded of Georgia. Russia's promises of Kutaisi and Tbilisi. However, protection of one's rights proved to be a difficult task, especially for Capuchin friars. Governor Russo did not forgive Georgia, the three Capuchin padres who sacrificed their life to the Western orientation of Georgia and despite full subjugations of Georgia. Never forgot about the reckless European plans and launched a target persecution of Capuchins. It first prohibited the use of Georgian and European languages in their paperwork and demanded them to compose documents in Russia or provide copies in Russia. So it looks like Georgian, it's a Georgian text from Capuchins is a Russian translation. Then it requires a withdrawal from the jurisdiction of Rome on the following grounds. Georgia does not exist anymore. It has become provinces of the Georgian Russian Empire, and the Russian Empire does not recognize the jurisdiction of Rome in its territory. From 1801, Governor Russo launched criminal cases against each Capuchin serving in Georgia. It is a criminal case, it's Povestka. In Russia, of course, on forged charges, some of them being related to property disputes and others even to anti-governmental activities. Orthodoxy is a major value of the Russian state, and the misleading of inexperienced people into accepting Catholicism, of which the Capuchins are blamed for, its targets against the Russian state. The process came to end on the 2nd of January 1825, when all Capuchins, it was about 30 in person, were placed in gendarmes' carriages and forcibly exiled from Georgia. They were first taken to Erzurum in Turkey, where each of them was given a court notice. This is a court notice, Povestka in Russian, stating that cases had been launched against them, against each Capuchin padres. They were warned that in the case of entering Georgia, they would be immediately arrested. It was not until 2011 that the Capuchins returned in Georgia. The Victorian pseudo-religious narrative completely erased from collective memories and microhistories reflecting the relations with the West. Furthermore, the pseudo-religious myth of shared religion or common fight and the century-old friendship between two Christian nations took over the historical function of religion in Georgia and continued to use the same strategy to establish itself as a guardian of common fight, and especially today's as a guardian the sanctity of family. Thank you for your attention.